And I encourage you to open to 1 Samuel. We'll be finishing up chapter 1 and going into chapter 2 today. If you're using the Bibles provided for you, find on page 225. Well, if you didn't know, this past Wednesday was Valentine's Day. And if you were supposed to get a gift and you didn't, it's too late. So just letting you know that. Public service announcement. No. I mentioned that because it was Valentine's Day, and perhaps you went out and you bought a gift for that special someone, and you took and you gave them that gift with the hope that as they would take the gift, they would open the gift, they would appreciate the gift, but know that it came from a heart of love for them, and they would reciprocate back love for you. It's the reason why we give gifts. I remember growing up, and I loved Christmas and I love birthdays for the reason that I knew I was getting gifts. And my mom and dad, although money often was tight, they would do their best to give me something that I wanted. And I would love those gifts. But often I would love the gift and forget about the giver of the gift. How often do we do that? When we get a gift that we really like, we have our eyes on the gift, but we don't have a love for the giver. As I've gotten older, I realize all those gifts that I was given as a kid, they've come and they've gone. And I rejoice in the fact that I still have my parents and the opportunity, while I still have them, to spend time with them because I love them more than I love the gifts they gave me. Let's take this to a higher level. God has given us incredible gifts. He's given us life. Every breath we have is a gift from Him. But not only the life here and now, He's given us, through His Son, eternal life. We have a salvation. Every one of us is a sinner. Every one of us is rebelled against God because God is holy and God is eternal and God is righteous. He needs to deal with our brokenness, our rebellion, our sin eternally, and we're facing eternity separated from God in hell, and there's nothing we in our own strength can do about it. But God chose to send His Son, the second person of the Trinity, Jesus Christ, who became human. He lived a righteous life. He went to the cross, and on the cross, our sin was placed on Him. He died in our place so that whoever trusts in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior is completely forgiven of sin, is reconciled to God, adopted by God into His family, and promised eternal life. What a gift. And we can get so enamored by the gift, we almost forget about the giver. Who do you worship more, the gift or the giver? In 1 Samuel, last Sunday we started our series through the Old Testament book of 1 Samuel, and we were introduced to a family, and this family was led by a righteous man. His name was Elkanah. He would take his family every year to the temple in Shiloh, and they would worship there. He had a wife named Hannah, whom he loved dearly, but God had closed her womb. She was not able to have a child, and then he had a second wife. Now, perhaps he brought Peninnah in as a second wife so that he could have children. And she had children. And we're introduced to this family situation where the two wives became rivals. Hannah, who was loved by Elkanah, couldn't have children. Peninnah, whether she was loved by Elkanah or not, she had children, and she provoked Hannah bitterly. And we see the situation. They go up to Shiloh to worship, and while they're there, Hannah is so grieved by her barrenness, so grieved by the provocations of the rival, she won't eat. She's in this place of depression, and she determines that she's going to just take it to the Lord. And she prays. And we see her desperate prayer in the opening chapter here. She cries out to God. And in her heart, she's crying out. Her mouth is moving. She's crying out. She's not speaking out loud. Eli, the priest, misinterprets all that. We saw that, but she's just crying out to God. And when it's all said and done, she's cried out. She's prayed. She's laid her desperate need before the Lord, and she left it there at his sovereign throne. And it says that she prayed, and then she went away, and she rejoiced, and she worshiped. Nothing's changed yet. She was content with trusting God, even if she remained barren and never had a child. In due time, the Lord heard her prayer, heard her vow of dedicating the child back to her, and God had his own plan. He provides her a son. He gives her a son. She names him Samuel, which is kind of a play on the word sha'al, which means to ask. God has given what I've asked for. We're going to pick up in verse 21 now. We're picking up that narrative, and we see, what does Hannah do now? She's been given a great gift from God. Is she going to rejoice in and worship and think more of the gift, or is she going to be dedicated to and worshiping the giver of the gift? I'll give you the spoiler. It's the second. We get a chance to see Hannah praising the Lord and giving herself as she gives Samuel back over to the Lord. So let's take and let me read 1 Samuel chapter 1, beginning in verse 21, reading up through verse 11 of chapter 2. The man, Elkanah, and all his house went up to offer to the Lord the yearly sacrifice and to pay his vow. But Hannah did not go up, for she said to her husband, "As soon as the child is weaned, I will bring him, so that he may appear in the presence of the Lord and dwell there forever." Elkanah, her husband, said to her, "Do what seems best to you. Wait until you have weaned him. Only may the Lord establish his word." So the woman remained and nursed her son until she weaned him. And when she had weaned him, she took him up with her, along with a three-year-old bull, an ephah of flour, and a skin of wine. And she brought him to the house of the Lord at Shiloh, and the child was young. Then they slaughtered the bull, and they brought the child to Eli, and she said, "Oh, my Lord, as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who was standing here in your presence praying to the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord has granted me my petition that I made to him. Therefore I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he has lent to the Lord." And he worshiped the Lord there. And Hannah prayed and said, "My heart exalts in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. There is none holy like the Lord, for there is none beside you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth, for the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble bind on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who were hungry have ceased to hunger. The barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and he exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked shall be cut off in darkness. For not by might shall a man prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Against them he will thunder in heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the horn of his anointed." Then Elkanah went home to Ramah, and the boy was ministering to the Lord in the presence of Eli, the priest. Let's pray together. Father, what a wonderful picture of coming to you in worship, dedicating ourselves to you, praising your name, rejoicing in who you are, and being reminded that our hope is found in you. Lord, may we today afresh take a look at your word and be reminded of who we are and who you are and how we respond and rejoice in you. Lord, be glorified now as we take some time in your word this morning. Amen. First, we see the picture of dedication, being dedicated to the Lord. The narrative picks up in verse 21. After Samuel has been born, and it's time for the family to go up to Shiloh for the annual time of worship, whatever feast it was, whatever specific reason why it was that annual time that Elkanah would take his whole family up to worship. When they go, though, this time Hannah tells her husband that she is not going to go up, that it's not time yet. She's not going to go up to Shiloh until the boy is weaned, and that's probably about 3 or 4 years old. The point was, she was not going to take Samuel up. She wasn't going to go up and worship until she was ready to fulfill the vow that she had made, and that is to leave Samuel there at the temple with Eli and his family. That Samuel would then be fully dedicated to the service of the Lord in the temple. She wasn't going to go up. She knew that Samuel was a gift from God, belonged to the Lord, and she was ready to give him over, but she wanted to prepare him for what was going to take place. Notice Elkanah's response. He says, do what seems best to you. Wait until you've weaned him. Now, understand, this is not just a passive husband that's just saying, you know, go, okay, whatever seems best to you. Right? In Numbers chapter 30, we're told that a husband, when a woman makes a vow in that culture, when a woman made a vow, the husband could either confirm the vow, affirm it, and stand with it, or he could oppose it, and the vow would be void. In other words, Hannah made this vow in her prayer. If when Elkanah heard about it, he could have said, I will not allow this vow, and before the Lord, it would have been void. What Elkanah does here is he's saying, I'm standing with you in this vow that you've made, and that our son will be dedicated over to the Lord. And in fact, notice what he says there, only let the word of the Lord be established. Well, let the Lord establish his word. And it's kind of a weird phrase, you know, what's going on? What's he saying there? Notice how they're perceiving the giving of the gift of Samuel. And we're going to see this a little bit later, even as Hannah begins to talk about that which I've asked for, I'm lenting back, I'm giving back. What they're perceiving here is they've made a vow. God heard the prayer. God gave Samuel. And so their understanding is God has a purpose for this child. God's word is this son is now dedicated back. There's a bigger purpose for Samuel. Let God's word, God's purpose, God's goals here be firmly established. And so their prayer now is in the fact that Elkanah is saying, I stand with you in the vow that you made before the Lord, that the Lord is fulfilling and the Lord has a purpose. Let his purpose be established. You see, we see something about Elkanah's perspective of who he is before the Lord as well. The dedication, we often talk about Hannah fulfilling her vow. Elkanah's fulfilling the vow as well. Husband and wife together, unified in serving the Lord and being fully dedicated over to the Lord. So when Samuel is weaned then, about age 3, maybe 4, family goes up, and they brought with them a costly sacrifice. Look what it says here in verse 24. And she had weaned him. She took him up with her along with a 3-year-old bull, an ephah of flour, and a skin of wine. And there's actually a translation issue here, because in the Hebrew it says they went up along with 3 bulls, an ephah of flour, and that ephah would be equivalent of the amount of flour needed for 3 sacrifices, and a skin of wine, which is a ton of wine, enough wine, again, for 3 sacrifices. The reason why many English translations say it's a 3-year-old bull is when you look at the next verse, they slaughtered the bull. And it's singular in the Hebrew. So the question is, what happened to the 3 bulls? Was it 3 bulls? Was it a 3-year-old bull? Honestly, we don't know. But here's what we do know. If it was a 3-year-old bull or 3 bulls, it was a costly sacrifice. You see, the family prepared Samuel, but they also prepared themselves to go for worship. And they were prepared to give over to the Lord a large portion of what God had given to them to commit and a picture that we're giving back this amount. We're sacrificing this to you as a reminder. We're dedicating ourselves fully over to the Lord. And it was a small picture then of the fact they were giving over their son to the Lord's ministry for the rest of his life. They were dedicating themselves fully. And then Hannah speaks with Eli. And there's a little bit of play on words here. She says, you know, as long as you live, I come. I'm the woman who's standing here praying in the presence of the Lord. For this child I prayed. And we lose it in English. But there's one word, the word sha'al, which means to ask. Kind of sounds like Samuel, also Saul. And we're going to see those two individuals being used of the Lord to lead Israel. One is a godly man, one not so much. But this word sha'al would not have been lost on the Israelites as they read through this. They see sha'al being mentioned four different times here in two verses. Notice how it says, for the child I prayed, and the Lord has granted me my sha'al, my ask, my petition, that I made to him, I asked of him. So twice she says it. He heard my petition. He heard my ask. He heard that the petition I asked of him. And so therefore I have lent, and that's the same word, sha'al. It's used in a little different form, but it's the idea of I asked, he gave, I'm fulfilling the ask. And I'm giving it back. I'm rendering unto the Lord that which is his. So as long as he lives, as long as Samuel lives, he is given over, fulfilling the ask. Again, that word sha'al comes there. So it's a beautiful thing where it happens in the Hebrew, on that word, and the playing with that word. But it's just that reminder of the fact that God fulfilled the request for his purposes. And the result being, as the gift was given, they're dedicating themselves over to the giver of the gift. And it finishes off here, and we have a kind of a bookend on our passage around Hannah's prayer now. Verse 29, and he worshipped there, the Lord there. And it's in the singular, but it's also speaking of the whole family worshiping. But he worshipped there, they worshipped there. In verse 11 of chapter 2, and Elkanah went home, and the family went home, and the boy was ministering to the Lord in the presence of Eli the priest. They worshipped. Worship can be defined as our glad response to God's goodness. Here they came and they fixed their hearts on the giver of the gift and they praised him. May we be reminded that everything we have, our possessions, our jobs, our income, our spouse, our children, our grandchildren, they're all a gift from the Lord. Everything that we might say is mine is a gift from the Lord. It's ultimately his. As we read throughout Scripture, all the earth is his and everything in it. He's blessed us with it that we may say it's ours, but ultimately everything we have is a gift from the Lord. And so are our eyes fixed on the gift or on the giver? Are we dedicating ourselves to the gift? Are we dedicating ourselves and all of the things the Lord gives us to him? Here's the reality. All of us are worshipers. There is a saying, it's been attributed to John Calvin, whether it started with him or not, we don't know. But our hearts are an idol factory. God designed us to be a worshiper. The question is, what do we worship? And when it comes to the fact that God has given us everything, everything's a gift from him, the question now is, are we worshiping the giver of the gift? Are we worshiping him? Are we coming to him with our praise? Or are we worshiping the gift and becoming an idolater? You see, so the question is now, how do I know what I'm worshiping? Well, what do you spend your time focusing on? When your mind is in those places where you're not actively thinking on something, what are you thinking about? Do you naturally go to times of prayer and just thinking about God's word and about him, or do you go to just kind of amusing yourself with other entertainments? What do you spend your time, talent, and treasure on? That's usually a good measure of what you're worshiping. So are you worshiping the gift? Are you worshiping the giver? They worship the Lord. Now, right in the middle of those bookends of he worshiped the Lord, and then the family went home but left Samuel at the temple, the tabernacle, we have this prayer. And Hannah's prayer is powerful here. It parallels Mary's prayer in Luke chapter 1 when Mary, the mother of Jesus, prays to the Lord and sings out a song of praise. And there's a lot of parallels. Many think Mary was probably meditating on Hannah's prayer as she rejoiced with finding out that she was going to be the mother of the Savior. Hannah's prayer begins with praise. It begins with rejoicing in the Lord. Look what she says, my heart exalts in the Lord. We don't use the word exalt much, but to exalt means to be overflowing with joy. We use the phrase jumping for joy. You could translate this, my heart, my whole being is jumping for joy in the Lord. Her heart, and the heart's that picture of the seat of her being, her emotion, her reason, her very being itself is just overflowing with joy in the Lord. Not in Samuel, not in the gift, but in the Lord. She goes on, look what she says, my horn exalted in the Lord. Now, she doesn't have a horn. She was a normal person. She didn't have a horn. What's she saying? See, they understood it was an agricultural society. You know, we see it on Animal Planet. If you're watching that show, you can see two animals fight. The one who's victorious, what does he do? Stands up. He raises his head in victory. The horn is held high. Right? The horn was a symbol of power and strength and victory. So when a horn was exalted, when a horn was lifted up, right, it's victory. She's saying, my victory, my strength is where? It's in the Lord. My rejoicing is in him. And then she goes on, and this line's a little harder to understand. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. Now Hannah has responded to Peninnah's provoking very graciously the whole time. She hasn't derided back. And now she's been given the gift. It's not like she's going to now start speaking cruelly to Peninnah. And in fact, in verse 3, she says, don't speak with proud arrogance because God hears it all. So this isn't talking about her kind of going back at Peninnah, but it's a confidence that she has in the Lord. She's declaring the fact that the Lord has victory. The Lord's victory is in silencing the boastful nagging of her enemy. And so she rejoices in the Lord and his salvation. See, the whole first verse there is just focused on praising God, praising him in all that is taking place. And then she says there's none holy like the Lord. She reflects on his holiness. There's no one holy like our Lord. There's none beside you, Lord. You are unique. You are the only holy one. You are the only God of all creation. In a world where there's many, many gods, many things being worshipped, you are the only true God. You are the one who is the God of gods and the King of kings. You're the Lord of lords. You're over all. You're unique. There is no rock like our God. Those two verses just exude with this praise of who God is. And you can just hear it. She's rejoicing and she's glorifying him. She's enjoying who God is. The first question in the Westminster Shorter Catechism is, what is the chief end of man? In other words, why are we here? That's the question. And many of you know the answer. The answer is, the chief end of man is what? To glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Why were we made? Why do we exist? Why do we live? Why does God give us such good gifts? That we might glorify him and enjoy him forever. Why do we gather for worship? That we might glorify him and enjoy him forever. Why do we sing the songs we sing? That we might teach one another and glorify him and enjoy him forever. That should be the kind of the mantra, if you would, of our corporate gatherings, but also our private worship. if we're taking time every day to get into His Word, if we're taking time just to spend time with Him, memorizing Scripture, praying, why do we do that? Oh, that I might glorify You and enjoy You forever. You are the giver of all that I have. Thank You. And I praise You. My heart exalts You, jumps for joy at the presence of, at the proclamation of Your name and to be in Your presence. She rejoices in the Lord. Let us in all things be dedicated to the Lord and rejoice in Him. Notice she goes on then to talk about the fact that because we can rejoice in Him, we can find our hope in Him because of who He is. Now we see there's hope in the Lord. And that's where she's going to go the rest of her prayer, right? So verse 3, she makes this declaration, talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth, for the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by Him actions are weighed. It's kind of she's shifting now to focus on what God has done, what God is doing, what God will do, and there's hope as we go there. And there's a warning, don't be proud. Talk no more so very proudly. It's a tough phrase to even say, but don't be proud in your talk. Don't be arrogant in your words. Don't have a heart that is lifted up. We need to guard against the sin of pride in our hearts and in our mouths. And notice where she says, God is a God of knowledge. By Him, actions are weighed. In other words, God's knowledge is comprehensive, that He knows everything. He knows every heart. He knows the proud. He knows the humble. He sees it all, and there's not one action. There's no person. There's nothing that is not weighed by God. That should be a sobering thought. He sees everything, knows everything. And even when our actions on the outside may be good, but our hearts are proud and wicked, He knows that too. God judges our hearts. Nothing escapes God's awareness. Nothing escapes His scrutiny. All actions, all people, all attitudes, all hearts are weighed by God. James and Peter both refer to Proverbs chapter 3, verse 34, when they say, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. And both James and Peter quote that. God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. And as Hannah's praying, she's declaring that very thing, that God is sovereign. God opposes those who exalt themselves, but those who humble themselves before the Lord will be lifted up. Maybe not in this life, but you'll be lifted up. She was not trusting in her own abilities. She's not trusting in the gifts that the world has, that God has given her. She humbled herself before the Lord, and He lifted her up, and she praises God for that. Verses 4 and 5 begin this. She begins to lay it out. First, the great reversals in 4 and 5. The bows of the mighty are broken. In other words, those who put their strength, or put their pride in their own strength, they're the mighty ones. They're the ones that believe that I'm the one who's the master of my own destiny. And they put their trust in their own bows. God is greater. God breaks their bow, brings the mighty down. But notice, God raises up the feeble, the weak, those who are humbling themselves and not relying on their own strength. God binds them with strength. Verse 5, those who were full, those who had plenty, those who were the wealthy, those who had food to eat, but forgot who gave it to them. So their pride was in their possessions. God brings it, so now they have to hire themselves out for bread just to have a morsel of food. Whereas those who were hungry have ceased to hunger. God has provided. They were humble before the Lord, and God provided for them. The barren, and this one gets really personal. This one's now Hannah's personal declaration. The barren has borne 7. Now, at this point, she had one child. So, you could say she's exaggerating. Now, what she's saying, 7 is the word of completeness. It's the number that represents completeness. So, we talk about, you see the number 7 repeated often when it talks about God's perfect number, the completeness, versus 6, which we don't want to get into 6, right? So, that's an evil number. She bore seven. She's complete. Now look at this. She was barren, is now complete in the Lord. She was broken and she was humble, and God brought completeness. And her completeness wasn't in having children. It was in the fact that she's now finding herself in the Lord. Now, we're going to learn in verse 21 that Hannah goes on. She has three sons and two daughters. So she still doesn't have seven. God gives her more children. But the point wasn't the fact that now she has children. The point was she now found her completeness in the Lord. The flip side of that is she who had many children has become forlorn. Forlorn being one who's in that place of despair. The point being, the woman whose hope is in her children is left broken and forlorn. Children grow up and leave the home. I have four children and I rejoice in each one of them. I thank the Lord for them. They're a gift from the Lord, and I praise the giver of the gift. I don't want to put my hope in any one of my children. My joy is not found in my children. Because our children will... they will disappoint us. They will grow up. They will leave the home. And they're temporal. They will die. So if I find my joy there, eventually I'll be forlorn. If I find my joy in a spouse, eventually I'll be forlorn, because our spouse will disappoint us. Our spouse will die one day. If I put my hope in any person, I'll be disappointed. We're in a political season. If I put my hope in a politician, I will be disappointed. I think we all know that, but we get carried away and we begin to say, oh, here's the hope. If I vote for this guy, that's my hope. Let me just say right now, there's an aspect where our hope should never be in that politician, because they're all going to fail us. They're all going to make promises they can't keep. And they're all going to die someday. Our hope should never be in a person. And that's the point here, is she who was barren finds her completeness in the Lord. The one who found her hope and her joy in the children was then forlorn. May we never put our hope and our fulfillment in a person. It's wrong for us to put a person in the place that only God was meant to fulfill. Whether it's a child, spouse, friend, parent, politician, whoever. There's the great reversals. Verses 5 and 6 and 7 now, and she goes on and she begins to talk about just God's sovereign rule. The Lord kills and brings to life. He's the one who has sovereign rule over the end of life and the beginning of life. He brings down the Sheol and he raises up the heaven. He's got rule over our eternal destination. He makes poor and he makes rich. Whether you have a lot or a little, God is in charge. He brings low and he exalts. He brings down the proud and he lifts up the humble. Verses 8 and 9 point us to the fact that our hope needs to be in him. It says he raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts up the needy from the ash heap. And this is not a socioeconomic declaration that the poor are more valuable to God. It's a declaration that those who humble themselves, those who are poor in spirit, those who are needy in spirit, those who are broken before him, he lifts up. He lifts them up and he puts them in a place of honor. It says if you humble yourself before the Lord, if you're poor and in the dust, if you're needy, he lifts you up from the ash heap and he makes you sit with princes and you inherit a seat of honor. How do we have hope in this life when we keep getting beat down? Well, we run to the Lord and we come humbly before him and let him lift us up. When we fight and we're going proud and we want to make our own way, we will fail. And the phrase here at the end of verse 8, for the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world, can be interpreted two different ways. Commentators were kind of divided on this, and I love both of them. They're both very powerful images. One is that the pillars of the earth are what the foundation of creation is established on. And so the whole world is on the pillars, and he's the creator. He's the one who set the foundation of the world, and he's sovereign over it. So as the world turns, God is sovereign over everything that happens. What a wonderful picture for us. The other interpretation is just as powerful, and in an election cycle, this is good too. The pillars of the world are the leaders that are in the world, and they belong to the Lord. And he sets them as he would. He sets them over the world. And we might say, well, there's a lot of evil things that world leaders do. And yet we read in Proverbs 21, the king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord. He turns it wherever he will. There's nothing that a king, a president, a ruler will do that God has not, by his permissive will, allowed, and everything that they do leads according to God's sovereign will, God's sovereign purposes, and God's sovereign plan to where he's leading all things. Nothing happens. The pillars of the world are the Lord's. He set them there. They're his authorities, for good or for evil for us at this time, but ultimately for his good. That's what Scripture tells us. He's in charge. And isn't it comforting to know, even when we look at all the evil in the world, that God is still in his sovereign throne? And there's nothing that happens, there's nothing that a ruler can do that God has not allowed? It's frustrating at times when you see countries that are closed to the gospel and missionaries that are being put to the sword. We don't use the sword much anymore. Put to death for preaching the gospel. Christians, our brothers and sisters in the world being persecuted. You say, why? How is this good, Lord? And yet the work of the gospel continues on, and God has a purpose and a plan. He's still sovereign and sitting on his throne. There's our hope. And in fact, that's where she goes in verses 9 and 10. Because she's now looking beyond the here and now, and she's looking at the sovereign Lord who's sitting on his throne, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who does what? Look, he'll guard the feet of his faithful ones. The wicked will be cut off in darkness. Listen, our might is not found in our own strength. Not by might shall we prevail. Right? We prevail in the Lord, not by our own strength. The king, the Lord, the adversaries, God will be victorious. His enemies will be shattered and broken down. Against them, his enemies, he will thunder in heaven. The Lord is the judge, and he will judge the earth. He will give strength to his king. Now, this is interesting because there's no king in Israel yet. So what's she talking about? It could be looking forward to King Saul, King David, King Solomon. In one sense, I think it's looking at an earthly king, but this prayer is also a prophecy looking beyond the earthly king to the good king. The fulfillment of the word of the Lord to David that there will be a king on his throne forever, looking forward to the Messiah, looking forward to the Christ, looking forward to Jesus. In fact, God will exalt the horn, right, the strength and the victory of who? His anointed. Again, looking at the earthly kings, but beyond the earthly kings, to the King of Kings, to the one who will be victorious through the cross. So looking forward to Christ, our hope is found in Christ. So what about you? Do you focus more on the gift or on the giver of the gift? Do you spend more time looking at and thinking about the gifts in your life, those things from the hand of God, or are you thanking him for the gift and dedicating yourselves to the Lord? Listen, we need to thank the Lord for the gifts. They're good things, and we should enjoy them. But thank the Lord for the things he's given us and dedicate everything back to him. They're all his in the first place. Rejoice in him. Praise him for who he is. Rejoice in what he's done. Place our hope in him fully, that he will do according to his purpose in his time for his glory. Before I close in prayer, I wanted to just take a moment, and we do this now and then where I let you kind of speak to each other. And so let's encourage one another with words of thanksgiving and praise. So just shout one word answers to finish the statement. Lord, I thank you for. Lord, I thank you for. Shout it out so everyone can hear. Lord, I thank you for
today.
Jesus Christ.
salvation.
Hmm.
Sovereignty.
Faithfulness.
Mm-hmm.
Having a plan better than mine.
Mm-hmm. Yes, now let's take another step. Lord, we praise you because you are. Lord, we praise you because you are.
Holy. Faithful. Loving.
King of kings. Worthy.
Greater.
Steadfast.
The Almighty.
Eternal.
Promise keeper.
Sovereign.
Immutable. The one true God.
Oh, Father, thank you so much. I thank you, Lord, for these words of praise, reminding us who you are. Lord, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the gift of our eternal life, the gift of our very life, the gift of the church, the gift of our family, the gift of the relationships you've placed us in, the gift of brothers and sisters in Christ that walk this journey with us, that the gifts you've given, Lord, are plentiful. When we open our eyes to see it, Lord, may we not fix our eyes on the gifts. May we rejoice and put our hope and our trust and dedicate ourselves to the giver of the gifts. And Father, that's what we do. We come before you today and we thank you. We commit ourselves to you. We commit this church to you. Lord, we commit all that we have to you. It is yours for your use, for your glory, to magnify you in this world, to accomplish your purpose, your plan, and your time for your glory. Father, we praise you. And we hope in you. Work in us. Transform us that we might make more of you. Let us glorify you and enjoy you forever. Thank you. Amen.
If you have questions about what you've just heard, or if you want to know more about what it means to follow Jesus Christ, I would encourage you to check out our website, faithbfc.org. If you live in the Harleysville area and you're not part of a local church, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Faith. I look forward to meeting with you personally. But whether you live here or somewhere else, the important thing is to get plugged into a local church where you can grow in your walk with Jesus Christ and help others grow as you serve him.